Good morning. It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I appreciate Susan Warren making Dennis call himself out this morning. It was very nice of you. It's nice to see everybody here this morning. There are a lot of reasons not to go to church. A lot of people use those on Sabbath mornings. It's good to see you here this morning in the house of the Lord. I'm particularly encouraged to see an old high school classmate of mine. He wasn't in my class. He was always ahead of me. He's probably still ahead of me. Randy Pyers this morning. Good to see you here. Always nice to have visitors. If you're visiting with us, we want to welcome you to our church, and we hope you gain a blessing from having been with us this morning. Our scripture reading this morning is 1 John 5, verse 14. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come this morning asking that we would hear a message from you. Not the message of a man, but a message that is solidly based on Scripture and on your word. Lord, please hide me behind the cross. I ask that you would bless this sermon. Where I fail, I ask that you would take up the slack, as you always do. Amen. Not long ago, we had a sermon where I talked about the importance of Bible study. And many of you were here that day. Bible study and prayer are the foundation of our relationship with Christ. And so it seemed fitting that after having talked about Bible study, that maybe this morning we should talk about prayer. Now, prayer is a common subject. I mean, we all pray. We all believe in prayer. But I thought it would be good to go over what really is one of the basics. Because we don't usually fail on the big issues. We fail on the basic issues. Prayer is an elemental issue, an elemental matter in our Christian walk. So this morning I want to talk for a few minutes about prayer. But I'd like to begin by sharing a story. Now, I've shared this story 4 or 5 years ago. I'm going to share it again. You may remember it. There's a story is told of a small Texas town. And in this small town, a local bar began construction on a new building, a larger, more elaborate structure. Something that would help them increase business in this town as they competed for those who were interested in the things that go on in bars. Haven't been in one, so I couldn't tell you. The local church, which was right next door, began a campaign. They began a campaign of petitions and a prayer campaign because they were very concerned. They didn't want this big, elaborate bar right next to their church. So they began engaging in a lot of prayer, a lot of study, and a lot of petitions. Work progressed on the bar right up until the week before the opening when lightning struck the bar and it burned to the ground. Gone. Now the church folks, as you can imagine, were fairly smug about the whole thing. You know? As sometimes church folks can be. That is until the local bar owner sued the church on the grounds that the church was ultimately responsible for the demise of the building, either through direct or indirect actions or means. And the church vehemently denied these allegations. They denied all responsibility that would connect them to the building's demise. And they did this in their reply to the court. Now, as the case made its way into the court, the judge, who was presiding over the case, made a remark. Here's what he said. I don't know how I'm going to decide this case. It appears that we have a local bar owner who believes in the power of prayer, and an entire church that does not. How do we as Christians view prayer? Are we asking for something that we expect to receive, as these church members did? God answered their prayer, maybe not in the way that they expected it to happen, but God allowed the lightning. How do we view prayer? Now, I'm sure we all believe in the power of prayer. We're Christians. It's what we do. We pray. And at times we've seen prayers answered, miraculous prayers answered. Prayers for intervention, prayers for healing, prayers for restoration, prayers for discernment. We've seen these happen in our own lives and in the lives of others. But then there are those times when we're seeking for answers and we aren't confident we hear God providing direction. How do we view prayer during these times? What do we do when we don't hear a clear answer to our prayers? And we find throughout the Bible countless examples of answered prayer. Some of these examples are the stories of Moses leading the Israelites out of Egypt and through the wilderness. Everywhere the Israelites went, they faced obstacles, from food and water shortages, to vipers, to enemies, to outright rebellion in the camp. Moses had his hands full. He had to have an active prayer life. I think of Hezekiah and his prayer for deliverance from Sennacherib, king of Assyria, and God's faithfulness to his people. Elijah on Mount Carmel, as he prayed for fire to come down from heaven, and then for rain. Then there are the prayers of Gideon as he spread out the fleece. Hannah's prayer of thanksgiving for answered prayer after the birth of Samuel, and Solomon's prayer for wisdom. Christ teaching the example, teaching the disciples how to pray, and his prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. There are many, many examples of answered prayer. And we know that there's prayer power in the prayer. There's power in prayer. But what do we do when we don't seem to be getting answers to our prayers? Let's be honest, most of us will never lead a million people through the desert. Probably won't be faced with annihilation by advancing armies or need to call fire down from heaven. But there are those times when we need guidance, and that guidance can only come from God. And we need the wisdom that only God can give. There are times when we feel that we continue to bring the same request to God. Do you feel that way? Do you find yourself bringing the same requests over and over to God? What then? In Luke 11, 5 through 8, Christ shares an illustration about prayer. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as much as he needeth. How many times should we pray for something? I believe we find the answer in this text. An unexpected guest has come at midnight. The custom of the day required the guest to be served, but the cupboard is bare. Being midnight and with no stores open, the homeowner went to his neighbor for food, but he finds his neighbor in bed and his neighbor won't get up. It's easy to sympathize with the neighbor. It's dark. We don't have the convenience of modern electricity. They don't even have flashlights. To make a light would even require considerable effort. And even the fire had gone out. It's never pleasant to get out of a warm bed on a cold night. And no doubt getting up would disturb the children. And so he just found it hard to get out of bed. But the friend continues to knock. And Jesus says he finally got up because of his neighbor's importunity or persistence and gave him what he needed. Christ then plainly says in verse 9, "And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you." Christ is not suggesting that God is like the reluctant neighbor. The message of the parable is this: the secret of the power of prayer is persistence. We make frequent requests of God. But before our requests can become real prayers, we must, even as the friend at midnight, come in the spirit of urgent need. We must remember that heaven hears only what we are determined it shall hear. God is not a trifler. He is completely in earnest. He wants us to be serious about our prayer and the requests we bring to him. And often he does not answer us until we become tireless in our determination. Christ's object lesson, page 145, says, "Often he," Christ, "delays to answer us in order to try our faith and test the genuineness of our desires. Having asked according to his word, we should believe his promise and press our petitions with a determination that will not be denied." Note that there are qualifiers to Christ granting our petition. One, we must ask according to his word. Two, we must believe his promise. And three, we must press our petition with a determination that will not be denied. Remember how Jacob wrestled with the angel. How he said, "I will not let thee go except thou bless me." And how Jesus instructed his disciples, "Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." Tarry until. Before Paul received the grace sufficient for the thorn in his flesh, he prayed three times. It's important to note that he prayed without ceasing for many other things. So why keep asking God for something when God already knows what we need? It's true that God knows our needs, but in many cases, we don't. We believe we know what we need, and so our requests fit that reasoning. But many times, the things we are asking for are not in our best interest. And so sometimes the answer is no. I think we have all had situations in our lives where we pray for something, and God sees fit not to give us what we ask for. In Luke 11:8, Christ says that the neighbor gave him as many as he needeth, not as many as he wanteth. And therein lies the rub. A person may think they need a better paying job. What they need to learn may be stewardship. Someone else may think they need a break from a pesky or pushy relative, when what they need to learn is grace to endure. It would be nice to know the end from the beginning, but that is really not for us to know. The second best thing would be to know someone who does know the end from the beginning. And praise the Lord, we know someone who knows everything. We are told by the pen of inspiration in Ministry of Healing, page 479, that God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led. If they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of the purpose which they are fulfilling as co-workers with him. And so we learn to trust God knows what is best for us and that he gives us what we need when we need it. In Luke 18:1, Christ tells us that men ought always to pray and not to faint or quit. It's easy when we don't get the answers to the prayer we expect to allow bitterness, disappointment, a lack of understanding or hopelessness to cause us to question God and turn our back on him. But God's answer in his timing is always perfect. And that answer may be better than anything we had ever dreamed of. And yet, if we turn away from him, we may miss the supreme blessing of our lives. When we pray, we need to be asking God to accomplish great things in our lives. Every Sabbath morning, we have intercessory prayer as part of our worship service. And there are a number of requests that get submitted, and there are a number of requests that don't get submitted. As a church, we need to be interceding on the behalf of others. We pray for the sick, the needy, those who are struggling in their walk with the Lord. Here's the question. Do we really need, as individuals, prayer, the prayer of others? If we do, how do we know that someone is lifting us up in prayer? There's a tendency among Christians, and I won't say it happens here, but I'm sure it happens. There's a tendency to hide our struggles from others. We believe if others know we're struggling, they'll think that our walk with the Lord is in jeopardy. But we all have struggles. I don't know about you, but I need someone praying for me. Do we have struggles? If so, who is praying for us as individuals? Who is lifting us up before the throne of grace? Even the disciples, despite having walked side by side with Christ, had issues and needed prayer. In Luke 22:31, Christ says, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren." We need to be praying for each other. Who is in your corner? Who is praying for you? If this is an area of concern for you, I would encourage you to visit with a pastor or an elder in confidence and ask for prayer. We don't need to know the intimate details, but we will lift you up in prayer. If you're not comfortable with that, seek out a close friend or family member and ask for prayer. We need to know that there are those praying for us, and we need to be praying for one another. Now, we should be careful not to ask for things that we can easily accomplish ourselves through little or minimal effort. Effort. Let me give you an example of what I'm saying here. There was a story in the news a few years back about a family who decided they wanted to see God work personally in their lives. This has been a number of years. You may not have heard of it. But the family removed all the food from the house, and they made a covenant that they were not going to eat until God brought food to their doorstep. After a number of days, the younger children began to suffer the effects of not eating, as young children would normally do first. Finally, neighbors reported the family to Human Services, and a wellness check was performed at the house. It was discovered the youngest child was, in effect, starving to death. The children were removed from the home and provided medical care. Counseling was provided, and at the end of the day, it was discovered that the family had plenty of money and resources. They had money in the bank. All they had to do was go to the store and get food. Now, this is not what prayer is intended for. We need to accept personal responsibility to accomplish the things God has put in our hands. Let's not make the same mistake when we approach the throne of grace. Scientists tell us there's power in prayer. When the mind of man meets the mind of God through the medium of prayer, something happens. Duke University's Harold G. Koenig, MD, said it this way: "Studies have shown prayer can prevent people from getting sick. And when they do get sick, prayer can help them get better faster. An exhaustive analysis of more than 1,500 reputable medical studies indicates people who are more religious and pray more have better mental and physical health." In his Sermon on the Mount, Christ tells us in Matthew 5:44 to pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you. And this topic is a sermon all unto itself. Can we pray for our enemies? Can we pray for Antifa? Can we pray for each of our presidential candidates? Hope I didn't strike a nerve there. Can we pray for our parents, our neighbors, our friends, our boss? What about the brother or sister at church we haven't talked to in a while, someone who's wronged us? We need to be ready and willing to pray for everyone. We must have an active prayer life. We must be connected to Christ. This is the most important form of communication that we as humans can engage in. We are not making, if we're not making the time for an active prayer life, I just don't know how we're going to make it. I believe we're on the cusp of eternity. Think about what has transpired in just the last 8 months. I'm going to go through a list here. It's not intended at all to be political, so please don't take it in that tone. But you have to ask yourself when you see these things, when you hear these things in the news. The question you have to ask yourself is, who is to blame? Everybody wants to blame somebody. There are those who want to blame the president, Nancy Pelosi, the Senate, the Congress, the Democrats, the Republicans. Let's place blame squarely where it belongs. This is a sin problem. Satan is responsible. And those who engage in these activities are being used, and they don't even know it. And we need to pray for these folks. We need to pray for their salvation. In the last 8 months, I've seen things that I would never have expected to see. I've seen a mob rule mentality in the larger cities that is, well, just frightening. The disregard for police authority and parental authority in the world we live in right now is astonishing. Buildings are being looted and burned. People are being attacked, and many attempt to justify this lawlessness and destruction. We've seen a national media that is pushing a narrative that promotes the suspension of our rights, our liberties, our religious freedom during this emergency. Social media is restricting and deplatforming any voice that questions the dominant narrative. There are fact checkers that are pushing a personal agenda that is absent of all fact. Dissenters of the dominant narrative are demonized online and in the media. Their motives are impugned, and they are ascribed the worst possible motives for daring to question the narrative. Gatherings for worship have been banned in the interest of public safety. Law enforcement has been dispatched in a number of situations. Those being arrested or dispersed are being told their rights are suspended. The First Amendment has been swept aside to fit the popular narrative. There's a story, an instance, where the governor allowed the casinos to open at 50% of capacity and churches at 25% of capacity. So one of the local pastors rented space in the local casino and brought his entire congregation in for church. Now, I'm not sure how it happened, but the casino got fined for that. We're just seeing some very unusual things. State attorney generals are revoking business licenses and registrations, denying the ability to buy, sell, bank, or make a living. Now, does any of this sound kind of familiar to us as Adventists? This is kind of scary. When you actually say it out loud, it's kind of scary. Travel is being restricted. International travel, in many instances, and in some cases, local travel is being restricted. Truth is being declared as hate speech. If you pose a position that contradicts the popular narrative, you are engaging in hate speech. This is already happening in other parts of the world, in other countries. But on our college campuses, on many college campuses, the call to repentance is a repudiation of the doctrine of safe spaces and is being rendered as hate speech. Now, in most cases, the decisions that have been made to enact and enforce some of these laws, I don't believe has been done maliciously. But make no mistake, the pieces of the puzzle are falling into place. Within 8 months, we have seen the restriction of worship, a national narrative toward the restriction of rights, mob rule, a dominant narrative that rejects alternative thought, the restriction of commerce limiting the ability to buy or sell, travel restrictions, and truth being demonized in 8 months. And if these actions could be taken during a health crisis, we can find another crisis to enforce these restrictions in. We should not be shocked or surprised. We've been told in God's word that many of these things will happen. But we do need to be aware. We as Seventh-day Adventist Christians need a vibrant, meaningful prayer life that will see us through. The relationship that exists through our prayer life is what will carry us to the end. So how's your prayer life? Are you covering the same ground every day, praying for the same things? Now, there's nothing wrong with persistence in prayer. That's biblical. But we need to be covering all the bases, and we need to be praying for each other. Let's avoid the repetition of prayer. The reason the prayers of Moses, Elijah, Gideon, and Hannah were answered was because they had a relationship with God. They knew God. It's one thing to understand the theological constructs of our faith, to study the principles and doctrines, but it's another thing entirely to know God. And as it relates to our salvation, it's not what you know. It's who you know. We should understand what we believe. We should be able to explain why we believe what we believe, but the key is the relationship. The will of each of these individuals, Moses, Elijah, Gideon, and Hannah, was perfectly aligned with the will of God. One of my favorite stories on the importance of prayer, of the prayer relationship, is one that was shared by Barry Black, the chaplain of the U.S. Senate. You may have heard this. Chaplain Black tells it this way, and I may not have this perfectly correct, so don't come up to me afterwards. And well, I actually do, because I'd like to get it correct. So I can't find it anywhere. I've looked for it online. I just can't find it. But Barry Black says, you know, as chaplain of the Senate, I can be in front of any U.S. senator in 2 hours. It's the privilege of the position. As chaplain of the U.S. Senate, I can be in front of any committee chairman within 8 hours. As chaplain, I can be in front of the president of the Senate, which is the vice president of the United States, within 1 week. As chaplain, I can be in front of the president of the United States with a 21-day notice. But anytime I want, I can get on my knees and pray to the God of the universe. We underestimate the connection that is available to us. We must avail ourselves of this connection. From the book Steps to Christ, prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Not that it is necessary in order to make known to God what we are, but in order to enable us to receive Him. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but brings us up to Him. The privilege of prayer is one we need to take seriously. You know, despite all that is happening in the world around us, we need to recognize that this is not the time to panic. This is the time to be serious Christians. Serious Bible-believing, praying Christians. Now's the time to work on a relationship with the Lord. Spend time in prayer. Seek God's will for your life. Allow Him to lead. Let's all get home together.
Well, shall we stand and sing our closing song, 499, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we leave this place, help us to make you first, last, and always in our thoughts and in our plans. Help us to spend more time with you. Help us to be ready, Lord, when you come. Amen.